Safety 24/7.
My focus is on a cultural and social conundrum found within the confines of this text. It speaks about the seed of the woman. I was curious as I looked at this because it's the only place where the seed, the importance of the seed, is linked to the woman. To the Hebrew mind, this must have been a conundrum because they would understand that the importance of the seed was always linked to the man. So when we read in the earlier chapters of Genesis, we read so-and-so is a son of, and is a son of, and in the son of, even when you read the accounts of Jesus' lineage as given by Luke and Matthew, they all trace Jesus' lineage by sonship and by the father, never by the woman. With all due respect, so I was a bit curious, why is the focus on the seed of the woman? If you promise to stay with me long enough, you will understand what God shared with me. It should have been proper for him to say the seed of the man, but why the seed of the woman? Creation story opens with an account of a woman being taken out of the womb of man, and the woman eventually led the way into sin. Redemption's story speaks about a man coming out of the womb of woman to lead man out of sin. So what Adam got us into, Jesus will get us out of. Hallelujah! That's what redemption's story is all about, is the seed of the woman. But it's rather ironic that the woman who led the way into sin is the same woman Jesus says, her seed shall crush the serpent's head. Why did he speak about the seed of the man? Why the woman's seed? But more ironic and more paradoxical and more profound is the fact that when Gabriel visited this teenage woman, this teenage girl, on that fateful day out of nowhere and with no apparent warning, as far as I know, when that happened, something more profound was in the making. As far as I recall, as I searched the scriptures, this perhaps is the first time that a teenage woman is approached by God, who sent an angel to speak about a child. Are you still here with me? Many times it was a man who was approached, but here's a woman being approached. When God spoke to Joseph, he did not even speak to him as he spoke to Mary. He spoke to Joseph in a dream. Are you still here with me? And so even Mary would learn that when Elizabeth was pregnant, God did not speak to Elizabeth. He spoke to her husband, Zachariah. I pray, but now he is speaking to a woman. Are you still here with me? It's a woman. No wonder Mary asked the question, what manner of salutation this is? I've never seen the like of it. Why did he at least approach Joseph? Why me? Somebody and some theologians call this the scandal of particularity. Don't get caught up with it. I'm going to explain it to you. The scandal of particularity. For there is nothing particularly captivating or interesting or intriguing about this encounter. Remember, this is now recorded by a historian called Luke. And every historian is always concerned about dates, about significant events, to grind and to make apparent as evidence the particular event which he records. But there is nothing apparent, or we are told it in the sixth month. Worse than that, we are told she is from Nazareth. Then we are told she is a woman. Lord respect. Remember, this is about the Jewish mind. And then she didn't even have status. Zachariah was a high priest. But this woman had no status. How did God approach her? Mary was to discover, yea, she was to illustrate the unraveling of this Genesis conundrum. Stay with me now. I'm trying to build a case for my argument here, Mr. J.P. But God does not need anything in particular to do the spectacular. He can use anybody, anywhere, anytime, anyhow, to somebody, because He is there all by Himself. Could somebody say amen? He who started the work of creation, in case you didn't read it, read it for yourself. He who started the work of creation started in darkness. When darkness covered the face of the deep, then God breathed, the Spirit moved over the face of the deep. He is going to repeat it with Mary. Because Jesus is light. And for 9 months, He is going to be incarcerated in darkness. Oh, Lord, have mercy. And out of that dark room will come the light of the world. Could somebody say amen? I'm talking about Jesus. Jesus started the work in the dark. Because Jesus does not need your applause. He does not need to show up or show off. He can start behind the scenes. There are many of us who like the light. But when God is about to do something spectacular in your life, He usually starts behind the scenes. When nobody can see you, ask my friend David. When David was in the wilderness, nobody saw him. Nobody knew what he was doing, so much so that when he came to face Goliath, he had to give them his resume. Because nobody even knew he was qualified. Because they didn't take note of you. There are some of you, people haven't taken note of you. Because God is working with you behind the scenes. That somebody told him he was doing something behind the scenes that nobody knows. But he is working, and soon he will take you out from the night and bring you into the. That's the kind of God I serve. When Mary heard these words from the angels, she asked a very troubling question. How shall this be, seeing that I know not a man? I'm talking about unraveling the conundrum. She is answering the conundrum of Genesis 3:15. The seed of the woman. Stay with me now. The seed of the woman. She said, how shall this be, seeing that I know not a man? Little did she know that the answer was in the question. She asked, how can this be when I know not a man? That's right. Let me go this side. Let me go this side. How can this happen when I know not a man? Yes. What do you mean, yes? If you knew a man, it will not happen. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Have mercy. Have mercy. Remember, it must be the seed of the woman. Oh, Lord, mercy. The man cannot get involved. He will contaminate the seed. Are you still here with me? Hallelujah! This is the God I serve. It could not have happened. Had it been for interference of man. And I hear some young person or somebody asking that question today. How shall I go on seeing that he's no longer around? Answer, you will get along now that he is gone. Now that he is gone. How shall you achieve seeing that you have been a failure? You will achieve because you fail. Pastor, what on earth are you saying? Have you asked people? Peter was toiling all the night at a time when it was best suited for fishing. But he caught nothing. But now he started when Jesus came into a boat. When Jesus came into a boat, if he had caught the night, he would not have seen the light. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Therefore, the lesson is that Peter not failed when he was expected to succeed. He would not have succeeded when he was expected to fail. And there are some people who expect you to fail. Because of your background, they expect you to fail. Because of what you have done, you are expected to fail. Because of your record, you are expected to fail. But just let Jesus step inside your boat. And you will see, I can do all things. I can do all things. I can do all things. So Christ who strengthens me. With man, it's impossible. But with God. I serve a good God. I serve a good God. How shall I be able when I don't have the requisite qualifications? Answer, you will be efficient despite your deficiencies. Because God does not always call the qualified. Sometimes he qualifies the call. Could somebody say amen? Woo! Heard Paul saying, not many mighty men are called. So God is not always and only interested in those who are able. He looks for the ones who are available. And I'm so delighted that Mary was available. Because if he commands mortalize this event, and the timing of the event was inconspicuous. Luke himself admits it was just for 6 months. Nothing really. I mean, how does a historian put the facts together? Could you imagine Luke trying to connect this event with something special? There was nothing authenticious. The place was not popular. It was an unpopular place. The woman was of no estate. There was no prominent person to which you can link Mary to tell you that this happened at a particular time. So how does a historian relate this account? It was inconspicuous. Inconspicuous to mortal eyes. But I want to tell you that the timing was impeccable. You see, God did not just want a virgin. You thought that's all you want to know. He had to have the right place, the right person, the right period, but he needed the right care. And you're wondering, what am I talking about? See, if God just wanted a virgin, he could have called her when she was single. But if the plan must work according to plan, she must be expound. That's the one he's getting at. I'm so glad I caught your attention. She must be expound. Remember, this person who is going to be born must be God and man, without being contaminated by man, for him to become the seed of the woman. Are you still here with me? No. It had the Holy Spirit overshadowed Mary when she was single, then Jesus could not have been seen of the tribe of Judah. Because the lineage of the seed was determined by the man. Say it with me now. Before Mary was of the line of Judah, he could not have been called the line of the tribe of Judah unless she was exposed to somebody of that lineage. Are you still with me? But there is the challenge. She must be of the line, he must be of the line of Judah by her being exposed to the man. But being exposed to the man, she must not consummate the marriage with Joseph before the Holy Spirit overshadowed her, then she could no longer be considered as a virgin. Let me break it down for you. The timing had to be impeccable. Jesus needed a woman who was a spouse. Now, wait a minute. This is not engagement. In the Jewish society, there is no such thing as engagement. There is the first stage of marriage and the final stage of marriage. In the first stage of marriage, it was legal. The couple said, "I do," formally to each other, but they just could not consummate the marriage. Sometimes the consummation took place about a year after, when the man went to prepare a place. Allusion of this is made in the Song of Solomon. "He brought me to the banqueting house, and his banner over me is love." So he will go and prepare a place and talk to his father. And when the father was satisfied that the house was completed, he will say, "Son, now let's go for your bride." That's why Jesus said in the same context, "Not even I know when I'm coming back. It's my Father who has it in his back pocket. He knows the time. He determines when it's time for me to come back to get my bride." So before he left, he spoke to his bride. He said, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Hallelujah. In my Father's house and many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. But I go prepare a place for you. And if I go, it implies I'm coming back." Hallelujah! Coming back. And so, the first stage of the marriage was consummated. When we hear the words espoused or betrothed, that is the first stage of marriage. And you can only break the betrothal by legal means only. So if she was found to be the child, even during the betrothal, she could be stoned. If the child was not a husband. So you could understand Joseph's anxiety when he found out, the Bible says in Matthew chapter 2, I think, verses 10 and 11, that Joseph, being a just man, wanted to put her away privately because he didn't want her to suffer shame. Are you still with me? And then an angel came and said, no, I want you to go through the shame with her. Come on, no, keep off your wife. I want the both of you to stay together because I need you, Joseph. But for Jesus to be of the tribe, he needed the name of Joseph. Oh, Lord, have mercy. So, on the one hand, she must be espoused for Jesus to receive his lineage as man. But she must not be touched for Jesus to receive his divinity as God. Because he is going to be the God-man. He is the only man that can be the God-man without a split personality. Are you familiar with me? So he needed the woman and the man. So he needed the right place, the right person, the right period, and the right pair, or the right couple. Well, now we can understand Gabriel's dilemma. I call that dilemma. And a problem he had in defining who this child was. He said, "This thing born inside of you shall be called a holy king." Now I must confess to you, Pastor Kevin, when I read this text years ago, I thought it was rather offensive. How can you refer to my Savior, my deliverer, my lily of the valley, my rose of Sharon, the one who saved me, the one who was and is to come, Jesus, as a thing? But you must understand Gabriel's dilemma. Gabriel had never seen God in this fashion. He was accustomed by holy, holy, holy. He knew God to be the creator of milk, not the drinker of it. He took his time and fashioned and formed the breast. Now you must suck. from the breast that he created. He who is creator must become the created by still remaining the creator. Your other saw him as created. Hold that verse. How can this be? He had never seen this happen before. The light being saturated by darkness. But man, I've never seen this. So I can't say that holy boy. Because he's not just a boy. But neither can I say holy God. Because God cannot be born. That's why I make a mockery of those who claim we're going to celebrate his birth. But okay, you're going to celebrate his birth, that's nice. How old is he? I can hear Jesus responding to the question, how old am I? Okay, on my mother's side or on my father's side? I mean, since then, back then, on my mother's side, I could be a few thousand years old. But on my father's side, I am the ancient. And the ancient of days. And before Abraham was, I am. So how do you put a full stop? How can you put me on the calendar of your event? I don't have a birthday. Even wise men knew that. When they came to the main, when they came to Jerusalem, they asked a very troubling question. Where is he? Wait. There is another conundrum, Pastor Kevin. Where is he who is born? Where is he who is born? Don't you see a conundrum there? People were never born king. They first have to become a prince. And they have to wait till the king dies. But Jesus cannot become what he already is. Hallelujah! He already is king. So where is he who is born king? Hallelujah! So even the wise men knew he was a special child. They brought gold for his divinity. Frankincense to declare what he came to do, to reconnect man with God. And myrrh was used to bury dead people. So even in his birth, they saw death. So you can't celebrate the manger without looking to the cross. Oh Lord, have mercy. And that's why I cherish not the old rugged manger, but I cherish the old rugged cross. So when the angel Gabriel was seeking to find the scripture words for this conundrum, he said, I don't know what to call him, Mary. Just call him a holy thing. Now you have to have the attitude when you say it. He is not holy thing. No. This is a holy thing. You got to have the finesse. It's a holy thing. A holy thing. You see, Jesus came to show us that it's possible for God and man to dwell together in the same flesh as brother and get along. When you and God can get along, you become a holy attitude. That thing. Come on. It's that thing. Holy thing. Pity when men call upon you as a king. Hey, watch it. I'm a holy. But I want to declare to you, brothers and sisters, that a holy thing is a person who used to be a bandit but now walking the Christian path. The things you used to do, you do them no more. People can't understand how you're walking so straight. They expected you to give up when you accepted Jesus. They gave you 6 months, some gave you 9 months, some gave you 1 year. But guess what? You are still here because you are a holy. Still here. I felt like leaving, but I'm still here. Some of you left, but you came back here.
And because of the life you are living, people don't know whether to call you what you used to be or what you will become. Just tell them, call me holy.
That's why, brothers and sisters, I am eternally delightful and grateful for Mary's response. She didn't understand how this was going to happen. She had never experienced it in her life. She recognized that Gabriel was having difficulty in describing the event. Yet, she said, Pastor, the handmaid of the Lord, be it done unto me. She could have remonstrated and said, Angel, with all due respect, Joseph and I have been planning this wedding for a long time. If I get pregnant, his name would be in jeopardy. I would be stoned. They will call me all kinds of names. But she, in spite of that, understood she would have to walk the streets in a shameful manner. But she said, it doesn't matter. It's all for my Savior. It's all for Jesus. Sometimes when you walk for Jesus, it will be shameful for you. People will say things about you. They will think you are disgraceful. But once it is for Jesus, you can say what Mary said, yes. Yes. That's why I'm happy for Mary's yes. I don't know if I will make it, but I say yes to Jesus. And I'm so delightful because the question that baffled me, the question that haunted me, even as I was preparing this message, the question that haunted me, what if Mary had said no? What if she said, with all due respect, no? I hear some of you saying, Pastor, God would have gotten somebody else. Yes, he would have, but the person still had to say yes. Because if you search the scripture carefully, you recognize that after she said yes, the angel departed. Because the only reason he came down was to ask permission. Oh Lord, have mercy. Have mercy. And God right now is knocking on somebody's door. But you have been putting him off. All he wants you to say is, yes. Yes, man. Despite what you have been through, all you can say is, you know why? Because Mary, because she said yes, lepers were cleansed, dumb began to speak, blind eyes were opened, and even the dead in Christ rightly rose up again, all because she said yes. And that's the challenge I want to present with you tonight, because who are you depriving by saying no? When God called you into his church, it was not for you. When he called you, he saw somebody else. Yes, somebody's getting it. He saw somebody else. And when you say no, you are depriving God of working through the life of somebody else. We are talking about a rapid transformation, but it begins by saying, you have to say yes. But wait a minute. When you say yes to Jesus, there are some things you've got to say no to. We have come to a time, Pastor Samuel, where even telling young people, well, not the young people, but even those who are not so young are doing it, that to stay away from fornication is becoming so abstract and arbitrary. Pastor, your old fashioned, stop talking about it. Because everybody is doing it now. It's all a matter of how safe you do it. And sometimes you're perceived as out of style, not in tune with what's going on. But I want to declare to you that Jesus Christ is saying, yesterday, today, and forever. And I started off by telling you that the only reason you will stay away from fornication is if you get to know Jesus. Some of us know our laptop, our iPad, our phones more than we know Jesus.
We know how the text, rather, we know the text, rather than know the text from His Word. We know all that's in the Word. And I'm not saying we must throw away the phone, but I'm saying that you've got to say yes to Jesus. There are some things you've got to put off. There are some friends you've got to say no to. There are some BS and GS you've got to say no to, because they will bring you down. If they're not lifting you up, they will carry you down. Do I have a witness in this house here today? If you're saying yes to Jesus, you've got to live by saying no to the enemy. So you're searching Montego Bay. You're searching this auditorium for somebody who has been putting off and putting off and putting off. And God is saying, you don't know how many people are in this here tonight, but thank God she said yes. She said yes. And if you, like Mary, could say yes, many more blind eyes will be opened. Many more people will follow her. Many more people will follow her.